Hello all. Today we are going to talk about a very important topic. You know, every student of architecture has to go through this subject called structures. And you know, for a lot of us, structure is kind of a sad spot. So today we have an expert teacher. We have with us Dr. Gurkirpal Singh, who's going to throw a lot of light on structures for architecture students. So sir, welcome sir this morning.
Thank you. Yes. Being with you. It is my pleasure.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. I'll introduce, you know, Dr. Gurkirpal Singh. So Dr. Gurkirpal Singh has, you know, multiple decades of experience teaching architecture at various colleges in Punjab and elsewhere in India. You know, he is right now the HOD of Punjab Technical University campus at Khuni Majra. And he's also, you know, has taught in many PTU colleges, including for many years at IIT Bhaddal, that is in Ropar. You know, I was also lucky to be one of his students. And, you know, today, he has a very glorious academic career. He's studied at various national importance colleges, which includes IIT Roorkee, includes NIT Bhopal, and also includes GNDU Amritsar. So, sir, you know, I think we should directly jump into some questions, you know, regarding structures for architecture students, sir.
Definitely.
Yes, sir. So, sir, you know, I want to ask you like this very important question, you know, regarding structures and how students have to deal with structures. So students have this belief that structures is something the consultant will take care once they design the spaces. How true is this belief of students, sir?
We should have some basic knowledge of structures. Basic knowledge means we should be confident of the type of structural system which we are going to use in our built form. Because in many buildings, almost in every building, the structure is responsible for the form. You can see any example you can take of many examples. You can see the glorious examples are the Sydney Opera House and then the Lotus Temple in Delhi, the Pragati Maidan Pavilions. All those buildings are more of structurally possible. Without structure, such kind of architecture, we won't be able to build up. So all those things, we can't isolate architecture from structure.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
I feel that students of architecture can go to any depth.
Absolutely. 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 Thank you for
nothing to be afraid of.
Yes, thank you for your faith in architecture students. And, you know, I think structures, they take it as a big challenge, but I think it's not a big deal for them. So the next question, sir, I want to ask is that, you know, students join architecture from non-physics background. For some time, you know, the CO had changed some rules sometime in the past that, you know, non-physics students, people who have not done PCM can also join architecture. Do you think this decision was in the right direction, as students with background in physics tend to be good at grasping structures as a subject? So, you know, we thought that, okay, let us have creative students in, and maybe we can not include PCM students, but these students might have some difficulty in structures. What do you think about it?
Technology is changing at a very fast pace, like a lot of 5G, 4G networks and nanotechnology and energy efficient building, Griha is coming. So the idea behind that is, if one understands the physics, because technology is changing and if physics is involved in that, nanotechnology, one has to know the superconductors, the semiconductors, the other things. So once what the idea was, the student must have some background in physics, so that the advanced architectural technologies which we are incorporating in our curricula, they are able to take up, and in the market also, they are able to perform better. So that was the idea that led to the introduction of physics
The
eligibility.
Right. So, sir, you know, you've been teaching structures for a very long time. Even I remember that I, you know, studied structures under you, and it was very interesting. So what are the steps students can take to understand structure designs fully and grasp its fine details? If you could just, you know, give some tips to the students.
Yeah. Definitely. Listen, most of the students, I think in the first year or second year, haven't got hold of a brick even. They wouldn't have touched a brick even. Wouldn't have thought of the weight of the brick. Wouldn't have fumbled it or played with our conventional building material, that is brick and cement and all. So if you, I think, sleep for a week with the bricks or 10, 20 bricks or play with them day and night, so you will understand the dead weight of it. You will understand the load of it. You can understand the carrying capacity of it. You can stand on it. You can throw it. You can crush it. So structure is nothing. It is the weight. It is the load carrying capacity of any material and how the loads are transferred from one structural element, that is the beam column, to the foundation. It is not anything. It's not rocket science. It's very simple. Only thing is we have to feel it. We have to feel it.
So, you know, very good suggestion, sir, for all the students. If they can simply, you know, touch and feel and, you know, get a practical experience, only then they would be able to understand the numerical part of it, the theory part of it, because practical will give them perfect exposure. And for all the students, you have to just play with the bricks. Don't throw the bricks at your friends. And the next question I want to ask is, you know, the current syllabuses in most colleges don't teach structured design software like STAD Pro that you must be, you know, very well aware of. Do you think that only numericals approach somehow, you know, takes away the interest from the students? Because, you know, if we have switched to AutoCAD, 3D software and parametric software, why not even go towards, you know, structure software like STAD Pro, sir?
Definitely, we should switch on to the structural softwares. Instead, what I feel is we should have developed games. If the students can stick on to PUBG and things like that day and night. So if we have some architectural games and if we have some structural games wherein the student can experiment online, put the beam and the column and the corresponding proposals, one is able to give structural solutions to a particular problem in 10 ways or 20 ways and get it assessed in the software or in the game. Let it be a game form. So right. I think if we have games for architectural students, it's going to be a big success in a bit. And learning will also happen. So that's the way that should be there.
Absolutely. So for all the people who are listening, you know, STAD Pro and games and any kind of computer interface should be integrated as part of structures, because that is definitely going to make it more interesting for all the students to learn structures. Now, sir, you know, I want to ask this question regarding books available. Multiple authors have, you know, written multiple books on structures for architects. There are differences in methods. You know, some book says go by this method. Some book says go by this method. What is the method that, you know, the structure, the teacher or the student should actually follow, and how to deal with this confusion?
Yes, the methods, there were different methods in the previous years. Now the methods are different. Now in the coming years, the methods will also evolve. It happens. It happens as the technology, as the safety factors, other things, they change. It happens. It happens. It will happen. We can't. Education is a growing field. Technology, knowledge, it's growing. So it will change. Always it will change. But one thing is definite, the basics of any science, any architecture, any engineering will never change. What right. structural systems or what structural thought has gone in making of a Taj Mahal, it is still standing. So means that the calculations that they did at that time stands true today only. Because if the building is standing, means that is valid today also.
Absolutely.
So the old methods are definitely valid, but evolution is there. Yes, evolution is to happen according to Darwin and all. So we can't stop that. But yes, we should incorporate, and the old methods also we should respect.
Absolutely.
Because
absolutely.
They are much more successful. Yes.
Absolutely. Yes. Absolutely. Thank you, sir. So it's about, you know, the methods remain intact and they are, you know, universal and they have been eternal. But with technology, we can adapt these new methods into a new definition, you know, a new evolution, but the methods remain and the methods should be taught. Now, sir, the next question is regarding, you know, so a lot of architects, what they do is they first do the space planning and then they look at the structure. Whereas the part zero of NBC says that you have to have an integrated design approach. So, sir, my question is, at what stage in the design should the structure design be thought very seriously? You know, because sometimes people do the design and then do the structure. So what do you think about it, sir?
We can go both ways. We can think of structure first. We can go of form, because form is going to come first.
Right.
The requirements, the space is to be there. And then we can start thinking of structure at the preliminary stage only.
Absolutely.
Because it happens sometimes that the column comes in between the room.
Right.
The architect is not, gives a larger span wherein it's not possible to have it without columnar support in between. So then the very idea gets defeated. So
right.
Yes, it should be an integrated approach. After you have done the preliminary drawings and all, you get some advice from the, have a meeting with the structural consultant so that he, she guides you, that the supports and other things are clear and your spans are clear. So then it will be much smoother, right?
Absolutely. 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 Thank you. So, sir, you know, next question is regarding, you know, we are teaching timber structures today for design. You know, what is the relevance of teaching timber structure design when today we are just using RCC and brick, which is predominant? And if we are teaching timber for some reason, then why are we not teaching stone design?
I agree. Definitely a day will come about timber. I am also a very strong supporter of using timber as a building material.
Oh.
You will find that countries, China and India, they are only the user of these bricks. Most of the countries, you can see they are using the timber.
Okay.
For housing and all.
Right.
So timber is a sustainable material.
Okay.
We are having problem from timber only in India because
right.
we don't have much of commercial timber at hand.
Right.
And the cost is also very high.
Right.
If we start cultivating timber for our housing needs.
Right.
Start cultivating it at a large scale, then maybe we will have more oxygen, we will have more sustainable building material
yeah.
and the topsoil which we use in our bricks and all. That will be saved. That will be saved.
So what you're saying is that timber is a revolutionary material. It's a sustainable material. So go on, sir.
Yes, definitely. The advanced countries are using timber in their houses. Then why not? We are following them in each and every step. Why not? Why don't we switch on to timber and leave off this brick and RCC? Why not?
What about the fire problems, fire codes?
Yes, also about your... No, fire code is there also.
Okay.
Abroad, they have got also fire codes. They have got everything. Advanced countries, they have got sensors. They had put up sensors there.
Right.
Everything they have got. Advanced countries, yes, they have got everything.
Yes.
Also, the section of the wall is very thin.
Right.
Very thin section.
Right.
So, the dead weight is also very less.
Absolutely.
And about the stone masonry that you were asking, that why we don't address the stone masonry. Well, yes, definitely it should be. We should not stick onto one material. The structural design using the stone masonry should also be, the student should also be exposed to that.
Right. Thank you. I hope, you know, in the near future, stone masonry and, you know, working with stone, building with stone is also part of our syllabi. Now, sir, the next question is, you know, you, when you were beginning this conversation, you spoke about, you know, how, you know, there are structure-based design, like you gave the example of Opera House, Lotus Temple, and so many other things. So, you know, my next question is about that. There has been a successful structure as architecture movement where good structure design has been used to create an aesthetic output. Not only thin shell that you spoke about as Lotus Temple and Sydney Opera House, there are also trusses and suspension cables that can be used beautifully to create good aesthetics. Can there not be more stress on teaching through the structure as architecture methodology?
Yes, we should. My only submission is that we have to make the students comfortable with architecture, friendly with architecture. They have to be friendly. They have to sleep. They have to sit. They have to stand. They have to live with the architecture, with structure. We can't isolate architecture from structures, because architecture is possible only because of structures. Our human body is possible only because of skeletal system.
Right.
Similarly, architecture is possible only because of structure.
Right.
So the students should be made to experiment with different structural form, make models, give proposals in their design, and more stress and more comfortable they should be made. My only submission is they should be made more comfortable, and they should not be afraid of giving our structural solutions.
Absolutely. Thank you. And for all the viewers, just to let you know, Dr. Gurkirpal Singh is not only an architect, he's also a qualified structural designer. So, you know, he's just the best of both the worlds. So, you know, he's the perfect person to tell you that you should know structure as well as architecture together in an integrated and in a synergetic way. So, sir, you know, my next question is about this contempt and this bias towards highly technical design orientation people. You know, people might say that they are less aesthetic, they are boring, and they create dull buildings because they're only technical. So what is your view on, you know, this bias towards highly technical design, which people say might compromise on aesthetics and the experience? So what do you think about it?
Architecture is aesthetics.
Right.
It gives you joy.
Right.
You get mesmerized. Right. That's the wow feeling when you see a building. Wow. Right. And if you don't put in aesthetics, the wow won't be there.
Right.
God has created this world. You see the flowers, the beautiful things from which the human beings have got their concepts. Even right. You go to the Burj Khalifa, the concept of Burj Khalifa is a desert flower.
Right.
So that wow, that mesmerization has to be there in all architectural creations. We can't isolate architecture. We can't make architecture dull and boring, because we are designing it for the users. Architecture has to be part and parcel, aesthetically pleasing, and should have a wow feeling.
Absolutely. So, you know, we covered a lot today. You know, you spoke about, you know, STAD Pro, you spoke about structure design, how structure and architecture go hand in hand. You spoke about bricks, RCC, you spoke about timber design, you spoke about so many important information that an architecture student requires. I would request if you could give a final message to the viewers to conclude this conversation.
Yes, I would like to say a few words, and the words are that architecture, structure, art people, and persons from various fields, even the sociologists, because you're designing building for the society, not in isolation, people from humanities, all should be in the team, and the architects have to feel the society needs, the societal requirements, the feeling of the society, the security, and the humanitarian part of their buildings. Means their buildings should not be brutal. If you're building, you have designed a building that creates fear. A small child while looking at the building, I had seen some buildings that feel this deconstructionism, that the building is getting down, it is getting broken, and some buildings are toppled, showing that they are being falling off. So that creates fear in the minds of people and children. And so let's our architecture not be brutal, let it be friendly. And yes, architecture is, summing up of many fields, as many as fields we can bring together. So that forms architecture. It is a very big science, and it's a mother of all sciences. That's what I feel. In all my years that I experienced as a teacher, as a consultant, as my journey as an architect.
Right.
That's all I would like to sum it.
Thank you, sir. We are so glad to have you today, and you gave such important information and wisdom, you know, to all the architecture students and architects regarding architecture, structures, and the all fine details about studying structures and the whole domain paradigm about this area. And, you know, thank you so much again. And for all the viewers, you're please requested to put your comments. If you have any questions, if you have any further doubts, put it down in the comment section below. And please like this video and subscribe to this channel, and see you in the next video. Thank you so much.